Welcome back, and we hope you had a good lunch and productive time with your demonstrations as well as roundtable discussions. We are going to start our third panel for the day, but just before that, we have a special appearance. There's one of our entrepreneurs from Bailahampur in Belagavi. He's a dairy farmer, so he'll come here and will share his entrepreneurial experience. Please welcome Mr. Madhya to Belagavi.
ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನನ್ನ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಡೈರಿ ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಪೈಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಮೂರು ಹಸುಗಳಿದ್ದವು ಸರ್. ಮೂರು ಹಸುಗಳಿದ್ದು ರೀ, ಮೂರು ಹಸುಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಲೇಬರ್ ಬಂದರೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಒಬ್ಬರೇ ಇದ್ವಿ, ಆಳುಗಳು ಸಿಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಆನೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಸುಮಾರು ಸ್ಮೈಕ್ ಬರ್ತಿದ್ದೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಕೆಶಿ ಪಾಟೀಲ್ ಸರ್ ದಾಟಿ ಹೊಂಟಿದ್ರಿ, ದಾಟಿ ತರಬೇಕು. ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಪಚ್ಚೆ ಇತ್ತು, ಪಚ್ಚಗಂತ ಕರೆಂಟ್ ತೊಂದರೆ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಮಿಲ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಮಿಷನ್ ತಂದು ಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ದೆ ನಾನು. ಇವರೆಲ್ಲ ಸೋಲಾರ್ ಐತಿ, ಸೋಲಾರ್ ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ ಕಸ್ಟಮರ್ ಐತೆ ಸರ್. 2003 ಸೋಲಾರ್ ನನ್ನ ಮನೆಗೆ ಐತಿ, ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಕಂಪ್ನಿ ಸೋಲಾರ್ ನನ್ನ ಮನೆಗೆ 2003 ಹಾಕ್ಸಿ ಸರ್. ಅದು ಮಿಲ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಇದೆ ನನಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿದ್ದಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ.
ಸೊ ಹೀಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ಡೈರಿ ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಬೈಲಹಂಗಲ್ ಇನ್ ನಾರ್ತ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ. ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ 3 ಕೌಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಹಿಮ್, ಅಂಡ್ ದೇರ್ ವಾಸ್ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಆಬ್ವಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಲೇಬರ್, ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಹಾರ್ಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಟು ಮೇಂಟೈನ್. He thought of having an electrical milking machine because there are no labors to maintain, but electricity is a very big problem. There's a very big lack of electricity over there. So once he was introduced to the solar milking machine, and he was taken by a little surprise because he's using solar bomb lighting for a very 2003. So from last 16 years he's using, he's seeing how solar can actually light his home. But knowing that a milking machine can be powered by solar was a little surprise for
him. ಯಾರು ಸರ್ ಮೂರು ಹಾಕಿದ್ರಿ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಡೆಮೋ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರು ಸರ್, ಮಿಲ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಮಿಷಿನ್ ನಮ್ಮದೇ ಇದೆ ಸೋಲಾರ್ದು, ಡೆಮೋ ಹಾಕ್ತೀರ ಅಂತಂದ್ರು. ಇಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ ಫೈನಾನ್ಸ್ ತೊಂದರೆ ಇದೆ ಸರ, ಈಗ ಸರ್ ಮೊನ್ನೆ ಯಾರು ನಸು ತಂದಿದ್ದೀನಿ, ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ವೀಕ್ ಹಾಕಂದ್ರಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ. ಇಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು 15 ದಿವಸ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂತ. 15 ದಿವಸ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅಂತ ಆಯ್ತು, ನಾನು ತುಂಬ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್. ಅದು ಲೇಬರ್ ಅದು ಒಬ್ಬರಲ್ಲೇ ಈಗ 5 ನಿಮಿಷ ಒಂದು ಆಕಳ ಹಿಂಡಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ಹಸು ಹಿಂಡಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್. ಹಂಗಾರೆ ಅಗದಿ ಈಜಿ ಆಗೈತಲ್ಲ, ಹಂಗಾರೆ ಹೆಂಗೋ ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅಂತ ಸರ್ ಮಿಲ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೆ ಡೆಮೋಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಸರ್ಗೆ ಹಂಗಾರೆ ಹೇಳಿ ನಾ ಸರ್ ನಾ ಅಮೌಂಟ್ ಕೊಡ್ತೀನಿ ಸರ್ ಲೋನ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಸರ್ ಹೇಳಿ ಆಯ್ತು ಬಾ ಅನ್ನೋದ್ಲೇ ಸರ್ ಅಷ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ಸುಮ್ಮನಾದ್ರೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಹಸುತ್ತೇನೆ ಸರ್ ಒಂದೊಂದೇ ಸ್ಟೆಪ್ ವೈಸ್. ಸ್ಟೆಪ್ ವೈಸ್ ಅಂತ ನನಗೆ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಬರಕತ್ತೆ ರೀ, ಹಸು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಪ್ರಮಾಣ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಬರತ್ತೆ ಸರ್.
He was little hesitant in the earlier stage because he didn't know how it's going to help, but then he was convinced that okay, use it for some days as a demonstration, just see how it works, and then if you think it's actually helping you in your business, then go ahead with it. So he saw the consequences of using it, and from 2 cows it became 3, it became 4.
ಈ ಸದ್ಯ ಸರ್ ಆಕಳ ಒಳಗು ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ಸ್ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಮಾಡಿದೆ ಸರ್. ಈ ಸದ 26-26 ಆಕಳು ಇದೆ ಸರ್ ನಮ್ಮ ಕಡೆ, 26 ಆಕಳನ್ನು ಸರ್ ಮೇಂಟೈನ್ ಮಾಡೋ ಈ ಪ್ರಯೋಜನ ಮಾಡಿದೆ ನಾನು. ಆದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ಏನು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ನಾ ಪಟೇಲ್ ಸರ್ ಏನು ಬಕೆಟ್ ಇದೆ, ನನಗೆ ಮಿಲ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಬೇಕಾಯ್ತು ಸರ್, ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಬಕೆಟ್ ಇದೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಬಕೆಟ್ ಸರ್. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ಮತ್ತಿದು ಏನಾಗಿತ್ತು ಸರ್, ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಏನು ಖರಾಗಿತ್ತು ಅಂದರೆ ಹಾಲಿಗೆ ಪರ್ ಡೇ 180 ಲೀಟರ್ ಹಾಲಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್ ನಮ್ದು.
So he started with 2 cows, and now he has 26 cows and managed by just 2 people. So starting with a very small dairy farmer, now he's actually a little bigger dairy farmer, and he also says
double cluster. Single cluster to double cluster.
Yes, yeah, so single cluster, double cluster. So it's just a specification because if the single cluster was like suffice his earlier needs, but now he went for the double cluster as well. And now he makes 180 liters a day. That's the amount of milk he makes. But the next story is interesting.
Next interesting one, sir, ಏನಾಯ್ತು? ಹಾಲಿನ ರೇಟ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಹಾಲಿಂದು ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಂತ ಹಾಲಿನ ಒಂದು ರೇಂಜ್ ಬಂದಿತ್ತು ಸರ್. ಪರ್ ಡೇ 200 ಲೀಟರ್ ಹಾಲು ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಂತ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂತ ಆ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಬನ್ನಿ ಬರಂತ ಏನೈತೆ ಸರ್. ಈ ಸದ್ಯ ಹಾಲಿನ ರೇಟ್ ನೋಡ್ರಿ, 1 ಲೀಟರ್ ಬಿಸಿಲೇತದ ನಾವು ಹೊರಗೆ ಹೋಗಿ 20 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಕೊಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಕೇಳಲೆ. ಅದೇ ನಾವು ಸ್ವಂತ 4 ಗಂಟೆ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಎದ್ದು ದುಡಿದು ಅದನ್ನ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಿ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಮಾಡಿ 20 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಹಾಲು ಬೀಳುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್. ಈಗ
So he had this dream of, being a good dairy farmer, and he reached that point where he was having 200 liters a day milk. But then he says people are ready to pay 20 rupees you know, for a water bottle. But when he actually wakes up four in the morning and they put a lot of efforts in, you know, bringing that bill to the market, but the market is not ready to pay that much amount of money for like a good quality of 1 liter of milk.
ಆಮೇಲೆ ಸರ್ ಏನಿದೆ ಹಿಂಗಾದ್ರೆ ಹಾಲಿನ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಕಂದ್ರೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಕೆಜಿ ಪಾಟೀಲ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ ಏನ್ರಿ ಹಿಂಗಾಗತ್ತೀರಿ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ನಂತ ಎಲ್ಲ ಶೆಲ್ಕೋದಿಂದ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಇದೈತಿ ಕಮಿಷನ್ ಹಾಕೋದೈತಿ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಹಂಗಾರೆ ನನಗ ಹಾಕ್ರಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ನಾ ಸರ್ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಇದ್ದಿದ್ದೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಬಂದು ತೆಗಿತೇನಂತ ಏನ್ರ ಯಾಕೆ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಭಾಳ ಬಿಡಿಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ ಸದ್ದ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಭಾಳ ಸಮಯ ಕಂತು ತುಂಬಂತ ಕೆಪಿಸಿಟಿವಾಗಿ ಉಳಿದಿಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಹಾಲಿನ ರೇಟ್ ಹಂಗಾಗಲ್ಲೇ ಹಂಗಾದ್ರೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಈ ಕಮಿಷನ್ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರಿ ಕಮಿಷನ್ ಹಾಕಿದ್ಕಿಂತ ರೀ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ನನಗೆ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಬರಾಕೈತಿರ ಅದು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ದಿವಸಕ್ಕೆ ಸದ್ದ ನಾ ಏನಾಗಿತ್ತು 20 ಪಲ್ಯ ಹಾಲು ಮರಿ 4 ಸಾವಿರ ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಹಾಲು ಆಗೈತ್ರಿ ಕವಾ ಚಲೋ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರಿ ಕವಾ ಮಿಷನ್ ಚಲೋ ಮಾಡೋದು ಏನೈತೆ ಸರ್ ಪರ್ ಡೇ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ಡಬಲ್ ಆಗೊಂದ ರೇಂಜ್ ಕವಾ ಮಾರಾಕ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಸರ್
So, the next intervention that happened with him was a Kova making machine. Kova is a milk-based sweet. So, because there was the market for milk was actually not, I mean, not making him earn enough how much he was expecting. Now, this Kova making machine actually added value to the milk. And now, it's making, I mean, this is, it just completed, I mean, it's from the raw material milk till having the final product as a sweet. That's actually making earning much more than what he was earning from the milking machine.
Sir, that's why I have a demo, sir. Kava machine. Demo, but it's like Kava interest, sir. Kava is the agri ashtoval Kava maarta hai, sir. Aur matto an samasya bande bittte, sir. Kya karre? LPG. LPG 1 kg Kava maro kar ye lagta, sir. 20 rupaye andre 30 kg Kava ko LPG kaliya karta, sir. LPG an dinna na ashtoval bati bagar 1 per day. Per day 1 gas LPG sigatla. ಎಲ್ ಪಿ ಸಿಗದಂತ ಮಾತಾಡಿ ಸರ್ ಈ ಹಿಂಗೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನೋದ್ಲೆ ಮತ್ತೂ ತೊಂದರೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್ ಅಂತಾನೆ ಅನ್ನೋದ ಏನು ಹಾಗೆಂದ್ರೆ ಫೋನ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಸರ್ ಫೋನ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಬಯೋಗ್ಯಾಸಿಗೆ ಕಾಂಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಡೋ ಸರ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಚಾಲೂ ಇದೆ ಸರ್ ಸದ್ಯ
ಸೊ ನಾವ್ ಟು ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ದ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಓಕೆ ನಾವ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಮಿಲ್ಕ್ ನಾವ್ ಬಿಕೇಮ್ ಕೋವಾ ಮೇಕಿಂಗ್ ಮಷೀನ್ ಸೊ ಕೋವಾ ಮೇಕಿಂಗ್ ಮಷೀನ್ ನಾವ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಕೋವಾ ಟು ಬಟ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಟು ಮೇಕ್ ಕೋವಾ ಹಿ ನೀಡೆಡ್ ಎಲ್ ಪಿ ಜಿ good quantity of LPG which was very hard because then we have the limitations of how many LPG cylinders we get at home. So then the final solution was actually through biogas. So the problem was identified and then the relevant solution was actually found. And now he says it's working fine. It's one. You can
see the chalomadi, sir. Kava machine chalomadi, sir. You got one thing right, sir. Kava machine chalomadi. One thing right, sir. You know, you can have gas in promo, sir. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸರ್ ನಮಗೆ ಬಯೋಗ್ಯಾಸ್ ರೆಡಿ ಆಗಂತೆ ನಾವು ಕವರ್ ಚಾಲೂ ಮಾಡೋದು ಸರ್ ಸದ್ದರಿ ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಗ್ಯಾಸ್ ಹೊರಗೆ ಈಗ ಇಲ್ಲ ಕಮರ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ತಗೋಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ತುಟ್ಟಾಗುತ್ತೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಮಾರ್ಜಿನ್ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್ ಈಗ ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಕವ ಒಂದು ಪರ್ ಕೆ ಜಿಗೆ 20 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಗ್ಯಾಸಿನ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ನಾವು 2 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಕವ ಹೊರಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ ಸರ್ ಅದ್ರಾಗ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಲಾಭ ಅನಿಸಲ್ಲ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ನಮ್ದೇ ಸ್ವಂತ ಬಯೋಗ್ಯಾಸ್ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಿ ಅದನ್ನ ನಾವು ಅದು ಉಪಯೋಗ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಮತ್ತು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಇನ್ಕಮ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್ ಆ ಉದ್ದೇಶಪೂರ್ವಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಈಗ ಸರ್ ಬಂಗಾರ ಹಿಂಗೆ ಮೀಟಿಂಗ್ ಐತೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಬರ್ತೀನಿ ಸರ್ ಏನೋ ಸೈಲಿ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕೆಳಗೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ಸರ್ ಈಗ ಕಾಂಡೆ ಹೋಗೋ ಸರ್ ಕರ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಾಡಿಸ್ತಾರೆ ಇಕ್ಕಿ
Yeah, exactly. I mean, his income has increased now and the biogas was installed very recently and Kova making machine has been done for like last 1 month and he already sees a lot of progress in his income generation.
ಸರ್ ಇದು ಚಲಗೋದಿಂದ ಸರ್ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಏನಂದ್ರೆ ಇದು ನಿನ್ನೆ ಸರ್ ಒಬ್ರು ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಆದ್ರೆ ಚಾ ಬರೋ ಒಂದು ಆರ ಬಹಳ ಯೂಸ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್ ಮೇವ್ ಕಟ್ಕೊಡೋ ಮಿಷಿನ್ ಚಾಪ್ ಕಟ್ ಚಾಪ್ ಕಟ್ಟೋದು ಒಂದು ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಐತೆ ಸರ್ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಕರೆಂಟ್ ತೊಂದರೆ ಆದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಕರೆಂಟ್ ದಾರಿ ನೋಡಕ್ ಬರಲ್ಲ ನಮ್ದೇ ಆದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಕರೆಂಟ್ ಇದು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಸೋಲಾರ್ ಇಂದ ಇತ್ತಂದ್ರೆ ಶಲ್ಕೋದಿಂದ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಅದೊಂದು ಅನುಕೂಲ ಸರ್
ಸೊ ಯಾ ದಟ್ಸ್ ದ ನೀಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಎಂಟರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಸೊ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಒನ್ ಮೋರ್ ನೀಡ್ ನೌ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಟು ಫೀಡ್ ದ ಕೌಸ್ ಹಿ ನೀಡ್ ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಟು ಕಟ್ ದ ಗ್ರಾಸ್ ಹಿ ನೀಡ್ಸ್ ಅ ಶಾರ್ಪ್ ಕಟರ್ ಮಷೀನ್ ಸೊ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಯಾ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಆಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಎಂಟರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಎಂಟರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಡೈರಿ ಎಂಟರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಗ್ರೋಯಿಂಗ್ ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಮೆನಿ ನೀಡ್ಸ್ ವೇರ್ ದ ಲೈವ್ಲಿಹುಡ್ ಇಂಟರ್ವೆನ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯಾ
ಸರ್ ಫೈನಾನ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನ ಸಿಂಡಿಕೇಟ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ ಸರ್ ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ ಸಿಂಡಿಕೇಟ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕಿಗೆ ಫೈನಾನ್ಸ್ ಆಗಂತ ಸರ್ ಏನಾಯ್ತು 20 ಲಕ್ಷ ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಲೋನ್ ಕೊಡ್ತಾನೆ ಸರ್ ಲೋನ್ ಕೊಡಿದ್ರೆ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕಿಗೆ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸಾಕ್ಷನ್ ತೋರಿಸಿದ್ರಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ 10 ಸುದ್ದಿ ಚಾಲೂ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರಿ ಹಾಗಾದ್ರೆ ಅವ್ರು 20 ಹಸಿವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿಬಿಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಹೆಸರು ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ ಹೋಗಿ ಒಂದು ಸರ್ಟಿಫಿಕೇಟ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ರಿ ಲೋನ್ ಸ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಗ ಸರ್ ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಅಪ್ಲೈ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ ಮಾಡಿಬಂತಾರೆ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ನವ್ರು ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಇನ್ನವರಿಗೆ ಕನ್ಫರ್ಮ್ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ ನಾವು
So there was a farm for the dairy farming, there's a loan scheme. So through which he got like a 20 lakh loan for developing the dairy farm. This is after he realized there is a potential for the milking machine enterprise. So he had two cows earlier, then he bought the milking machine, he saw the potential, so he took a big loan to actually set up that dairy enterprise, the whole dairy farming enterprise, and he took a loan from syndicate bank and a subsidy that was supposed to come, at which he says he's still waiting for it.
ನಬಾರ್ಡ್ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಸರ್, ನಬಾರ್ಡ್ ಹಾಗೇ ಅಪ್ಲಿಕೇಶನ್ ಇಂದ ವಾಯ್ ರಿಪ್ಲೈ ಬಂದಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಅವ್ರು ಬೇಕಿದ್ರೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಸರ್.
ಇಸ್ ವೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಫ್ರಮ್ ನಬಾರ್ಡ್ ಸರ್. ಸೊ ಯಾ, ಐ ಮೀನ್ ದ ಎಂಟರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ನೌ ಇಸ್ ಗ್ರೋಯಿಂಗ್. ಸೊ ಸಿನ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಟುಕ್ ದಟ್ ಬಿಗ್ ಲೋನ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್, ಕನ್ಸಿಡರಿಂಗ್ ಹೌ ದಿಸ್ ಎಂಟರ್ಪ್ರೈಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಗ್ರೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಸೆಟ್, ಐ ಮೀನ್ ದ ಫೈನಾನ್ಸಿಂಗ್ ವೆನ್ ದ ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಡೌನ್, ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಇಸ್ ಐ ಡೋಂಟ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಇಸ್ ಗೋನ್ ಸ್ಟಾಪ್ ಎಟ್ ಎನಿ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್.
Let's now begin our third panel for the day. The final closing panel for the day shall discuss on creating an enabling policy environment
for scaling energy-driven productive applications. It shall aim to gather an understanding of the various opportunities needed to bring in inputs at policy level that can help the adoption, uptake and scale of livelihood-linked sustainable energy interventions across different types of underserved populations. Firstly, we have Ms. Gauri Singh, an IAS officer who is presently working as a Principal Secretary, Government of MP in the health sector for the last 3 years. Her role calls for providing direction, policy support and strategic inputs to improve the quality of implementation of health sector initiatives, policies and programs. As a career bureaucrat, she has played a leadership role in helping set up a new multilateral agency between 2011-2014, implemented country-level policies and infrastructure programs for the Government of India, directed projects leading to the national and state level, and run large World Bank-funded development projects. Welcome, Ms. Gauri Singh. We will also be having Ms. Leena, an IAS officer in the state of Uttar Pradesh of the 1994 batch, Joint Secretary, Department of Rural Development, National Rural Livelihood Mission. She is, her flight got delayed and she is trying her level best to reach her on time, so she'll be joining us in a minute.
She's on the way actually.
Yeah.
Now we have, along with them, we have Sunil Kumar, GM at NABARD. And prior to joining NABARD in 1984, Mr. Kumar worked in, with Allahabad Bank since 84. Then he worked as a district development manager at NABARD in Bokaro and Dhanbad districts of Jharkhand. He's also worked as...
So I'd like to call upon Sangeeta Bakshi to come on stage. Thank you. Yeah, to join them, I'd also like to call Mr. Anish Kumar to moderate the event as well. Big thank you for all of you to be here, and I think Anish Kumar, so please take your call from here.
So while we go through the deliberation, just to request you to start with short introductions. This context setting, we had everything. We had growth, 13x growth, we had innovation, we had integration, we had processing. And we had what this panel is about, the narrative policies. So policies on the ground, the way they are, the narrative that he has, 13x growth, the loan has come, the subsidy has come. So that, in some ways, when you look at policies, they have this habit of playing funnily on the tail end on the ground. So I will start with you. In some ways, we are looking here at the intersection of livelihoods and sustainable energy. Our focus is on this session, and that's what I request the audience also to look at. Three things, surfacing of solutions, building prototypes and scaling them at one end. Second is looking at adoption, uptake,
at the committee and end user end. And the third is the ambient set of incentives that will get this going. And you have been at both ends, right from MNRE days to rural development, health, both ends of promoting solutions in this space and also encouraging people to use those system energy solutions. I remember 10, 12 years back, we went to Jhansi looking for solutions, solar energy solutions for irrigation. You had looked at solar energy solutions for reapings. Reaping, if you remember, a very large way we implemented that. Now, we heard the session before lunch. Did a poll on how many enterprises are there. There were few, and there was a very large chunk of federation of SELCO entrepreneurs, and many hands went up on the side. There would be many more which we are unable to surface. What it would take to surface solutions in a large way? And someone, if you say SELCO has to be replicated, you need to spot those solutions for it to be replicated or scaled.
So first of all, thank you for inviting me here. I think it was a great opportunity to look at the various solutions that have got developed in this period, because when we were working on the policy on off-grid, we were really struggling with moonlighting, and maximum went on to look at solar pumps. But the range of solutions that are now being tried out in the field with entrepreneurs, innovating constantly to meet the demands of the client, I think that's really very exciting. So let me put it like this, that if you're looking at, in the context of, in the Indian context, if you can't be doing a pilot and be doing it, at a small scale. You need to have a policy that backs you to move very fast from it being a small scale intervention to an intervention that can impact many more lives. Because if it's good, then it needs to be able to move to that scale. So I think my take on how a policy should encourage these kind of interventions would be that it needs to act as the bridge between the clients and the entrepreneurs, but also try and work with solution providers who haven't really looked at this space but have the solution, but could nudge them into making it more efficient and getting it powered by solar. And on the other hand, provide them the aggregations that programs like SRLM and all can possibly provide. So if I look at just the case of Madhya Pradesh, we have 2.3 lakh self-help groups, and I'm sure that's pretty much the situation in a place like Karnataka and in probably many other states. What happens is that most of the departments, most of the ministries, we continue to work in silos. But someone needs to look at the connect between where is the mobilization happening, where is the demand, natural demand that's getting generated, and to plug it in with entrepreneurs and with technology providers who have the bandwidth to not just interface with their end users, but to also continuously innovate and give them what is needed. Now, obviously for that, the role of the government would be not just to facilitate that, but to also provide funds and support in terms of funding. Because as of now, I see that the kind of, if there is a end user who wants to get on with the livelihood activity, and if they have to go to a bank, and you heard it in the last panel, there are a lot of issues around whether the bank will actually lend to them or not, which means that credit, availability of credit at rates not like 15% or 20%, which probably they would get because of the lack of the bank managers being able to appreciate what kind of technology we use. So we need to also look at funds at a cost that is not so high that it will lead to a very slow adoption. So all these factors need to be put together in the policy and look at providing a framework that allows these technologies to scale up faster than what it would in its natural and organic kind of pathway.
Sunita ji, if I were to come to you, Technology Information Forecasting Assessment Council is the technology think tank. I was reading Technology Vision 2035 and I was very intrigued to find you have a projection of millions in 2035. This was
for 2015, much ahead of SDG. And there you have, the projection indicates 30% left out or left behind. Incidentally, this is the language SDG use, leaving no one behind. The other interesting bit I found, you're looking at 20% of rooted or remote in that projection.
Sustainable energy livelihood nexus is about these two, left behind, left out, and rooted and remote. So, and you have done a lot of modeling exercises at TIFAC at a very high level. If you were to, and beyond on these experiences and some of the cases that you were sharing, if you were to elucidate that and see how we could look at this SDG 7-8 nexus.
Thank you very much. Thank you everyone to actually help. I belong to the STIFI, which is the organization, Autonomous Body under the Ministry of Science and Technology. Our intervention is more on the technology and science-based reports and the think tank, what we actually look for. We perceive some of the technology gaps and we see how we can try to implement some of the technology within the country, which is more cost-efficient and as well as feasible and viable. Like we have done this vision 2035, which is the, I think the, what we have realized what was envisaged in 2020 and what we could not do it, and then we said okay, let's look forward for the technology vision 2035. Herein, like we have not talked about the India per se, but we have talked about the Indians, the civilians basically, and that's how we have defined some 12 roadmaps for that. They are very interesting roadmaps, and this document actually talk about all these roadmaps, the grand challenges which are there, how we can make this India, like, you know, we can provide the security in terms of food, in terms of health, in terms of education, in terms of like textile, the roads, the transportation, everything is in energy sector. So this is what is being done, and like we've already done some 6 roadmaps today. Coming to the modeling exercise, like TIFAC, I mean, having a vast programs, but like one of these is like, you know, we have a tie-up with the institution called the IASA. It's an international institute for applied system analysis, which is based in Austria. This institution actually have a member countries from like all over the world, like 23 countries who are the members of the IASA, and India is one of them. Here in like, these people are very experts in modeling. They do a lot of system analysis, they brought in, bring in a lot of modeling support for all the socioeconomic sectors, and they try to link everything with the livelihood options and see that how we can still protect the well-being of the society and the human beings. And through this, we have come up with very interesting case studies, like we have come up with the, you know, the studies and the projects to do with the forestry sector, to the land use, the cluster projects which we have done, and we have still linked up everything with the livelihoods. Now, this important part of this is like, you know, when we do these studies, it's not that, you know, whether as entrepreneurs, as like what SELCO has been doing it, we're not trying to work like as a silos, you know. We see that the things have to move in, you know, there has to be policy intervention right from the beginning. So whenever there are studies which we take up, we ensure that the experts from the policy departments, the stakeholders, the institutions are all together, who nurtures these studies and ensure that there is a complete intervention towards the end when the model is being developed. So it's like we are doing the projections, we are doing the scenarios, we are coming up, okay, how the industry, the technology would look like, how the energy sector, how these, you know, any study which we do it would be in 2050 or 2030, how it will be projected. So there are little scenarios which is not just based on the business as usual, but it's also based on like some sort of a technology interventions. And TIFEC has been supporting all these institutions because we don't support in this India YASA program the particular innovators, but we support the all the institutions, the academia, so wherein like we give the support in terms of, you know, cutting out the literature survey, even understanding the modeling, even for actually visiting YASA and doing the modeling for with the database which they have actually collected through the primary as well as the secondary survey. And then we come up with a very India specific model. The YASA, which is like, you know, they have over 20, 25 years of experience and they've come up with international models and how we can tailor make to actually cater to our needs. We have to come up with some defined indicators. We have to actually when we did this GAINS model, this is it's a greenhouse gas emission interaction model, meaning if you talk about India, we have a lot of cementeries here, we have a lot of rickshaws which is operating here. These are the indicators which are not there in the global model, so we have to actually see that when we are doing this model, it has to be very India specific. When we actually worked on the forestry sector, when we actually came up with the carbon maps for the carbon sequestration, and we had ensured that how we can still see how we can manage the forest most effectively without affecting negatively the forest-dependent communities. So these are some of the things which we have worked on through this NABARD program. And there is also very interesting studies which we have worked on the cluster projects. The cluster is like, you know, we actually identified three different agroclimatic zones, which is like, one is like we were tackled on the water management issue in the Bundelkhand, which is a water scarce region. Then there's another region in Kerala where there had been like some problem with the soil fertility and all that nutrient balancing and everything. Then there was the institution wherein like in Gujarat, we worked on the land use. So how we can see these things, like we can model these things and we can have a coherence between all the three states and come up with a consistent data system and then we can build up on the common framework to assess the climate, the land, the water management and the soil fertility issues and see their impact on the livelihood in all these regions. So this is something which is very interesting. We have been doing it in through time back.
Fascinating. In a way, you know, looking at the entire ecosystem of institutions and looking at how these could, this kind of modeling at such a large scale could support livelihood action.
Yeah.
Sunil ji, if NABARD has been leading efforts in India in this space, multiple programs, you have the Climate Change Fund, and actually NABARD is one of the few organizations which has mapped interventions across SDGs, the sustainability report, it's a wonderful, again, a wonderful document. You have tons of examples within the NABARD ecosystem. If one were to look at NABARD ecosystem and its affiliated organizations, what could support acceleration of scaling up of sustainable energy power developments?
Good evening to all of you. It is a pleasure to be part of the last session. First of all, thank you very much, SELCO Foundation, for inviting NABARD to this important conversation. I'm Sunil Kumar. I work in the head office of NABARD in climate change vertical. We have a specialized climate change vertical, which is part of farm sector policy department. And we are standardizing water, domestic and international funds for supporting climate change projects. So you are not aware about NABARD, most of you. For those who do not know about NABARD, NABARD is an apex financial institution meant for promoting rural development. We are wholly owned by government. And our mission is to promote sustainable rural development. And when we talk about sustainable development, all the aspects which are being discussed here, they are all covered. NABARD works through multiple partners. We work with all banks, all commercial banks, rural banks, cooperative banks. We work with about 5,000 NGOs. we work with about 4,000 FPOs who have been promoted by NABARD. And we also have 150,000 farmers clubs at the village level. And of course, 8 million self-help groups, which have been promoted as part of self-help and linkage program. So this is how we work. We have pan-India presence. We have regional office in all the states. We also have district level offices. Now, coming to the sustainable livelihood part, it has been a very important focus for NABARD to promote sustainable development. So we have watershed development program under which 2 million hectares of land has been treated with various measures to basically to promote soil and water conservation and to provide livelihood to people who are vulnerable, who are in the who are generally poor and living in areas which are not very fertile. We have another program which is called Tribal Development Program, through which we provide sustainable livelihood to tribals. So under this we provide orchard-based livelihood, and we have supported about 6 lakh families. And under this program, we have planted more than 100 million trees, fruit trees. So you can imagine the amount of carbon dioxide which would have been sequestered. Then we have another program which is very interesting. It is called Umbrella Program on Natural Resource Management, through which we provide loan for livelihood, sustainable livelihood projects. And it is for the first time that NRM-based projects have been supported through loan. So we work with KFW and GIZ in this.
Yeah. These are very large programs with massive impact on livelihoods and looking at the climate change adaptation mitigation. Some examples where one has used energy as a lever of expanding these livelihoods.
For example, under UPN, we have supported micro irrigation projects, which are solar irrigation also, energy plantations. There was a program in Karnataka where we replaced inefficient pump irrigation pumps with efficient solar pumps. So these have been the kind of projects which have been supported. And for renewable energy, under our Rural Infrastructure Development Fund, we are giving loan to state government for solar projects and wind projects. We have supported Chhattisgarh government for installing 30,000 solar pumps. And we also help in having separate feeder line, solar-based feeder line for agricultural operations. So coming to the climate finance, we mobilize funds from Green Climate Fund, Adaptation Fund of United Nations Framework for Climate Change. And we also have a National Adaptation Fund for Climate Change, which is housed in Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So NABARD is the national implementing entity for all these three funds. And currently we are implementing 38 projects having a sanction of about 1900 crores.
So these are all with state agencies?
No, I mean with...
And the NGOs?
NGOs, state government departments and private sectors. For example, only last month we have given loan to Tata Cleantech for solar rooftop. That is a $100 million loan from Green Climate Fund. That is a concessional. We are also negotiating a loan from GCF for IMEA for supporting off-grid companies.
Wonderful. These are large-scale examples where one could look at energy-driven livelihood impacts. Energy, I know it's a lot of trouble reaching here into the chaos at Delhi Airport. And we, since morning, one has talked about the opportunity with SHGs just before you came. And Boy Singh was referring to the role that Sutherland and SHGs can play in furthering the energy livelihood Nexus. NRLM is with 50 odd million now mobilization across the country, 6,000 odd blocks. This is the largest mobilization globally. This is what I heard someone saying, 50 million under one roof. In recent years, NRLM has introduced a range of livelihood interventions. Actually, there is a booklet that NRLM with Clean and SELCO came with, where you listed out various solar application for livelihoods with SHGs. Many of these were live demonstrated here. So if one were to now, ma'am, look at these innovations, enterprises, and many of them are here in this room. How do we connect these with the SHG-based platforms, these LLMs, and LLMs?
Thank you, Anish. I'm really sorry for being so late. Won't have helped. So SRLM, as you had
just mentioned, that like we connect with, we have mobilized about 6 crore households and formed 51 lakh SHGs, mobilized 2.14 lakh crore funds to these agencies with RAF, CIF, bank loans, and all those things.
So this is a very healthy platform wherein women have come together. And these are women which are similar affinity based, therefore the cohesiveness stands and brings them further, takes all these women self-help group further to form, come together for livelihood initiatives. And for livelihood initiative, when we say, first we focus on the immediate livelihood, which is primarily agriculture or farm based. And we intend to cover them with a basket of livelihood options, which may be both farm, non-farm, so that some sort of income flow is there throughout the year and they are able to sustain and come out of poverty thereby. However, as the program has grown, as you can see from the numbers and the platform which has evolved, we have upscaled the program DAY NRLM with a new initiative with World Bank assistance, which is called NREDP, National Rural Economic Transformation Project. So this aims at upscaling value chain, market linkages, and all those things to already existing producer groups, producer enterprises, which are existing both in farm and non-farm. When you mentioned about the type of interventions which we have had for farm, for example, we have a focused program sub which is sub part of DAY NRLM. By the way, DAY NRLM, then they are Antodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihood Mission. So one is NKSP, which is called Mahila Kisan Sashaktikaran Pariyojana. As we all know and understand that when we say farmer, we generally associate some male figure with it. So these are the women who have emerged as farmers on their own. Whether the land is in their name or not, that is immaterial to us. But they are using this land more usefully for the purpose of for upgrading their own nutritional standards. Maybe a backyard patch which they are using for backyard garden, where they are growing at least 5 type of things which would add to the nutrition value which they bring on the plate of their family, themselves, their children. And the when it comes to farm, they have different practices which are basically agroecological practices, which basically, as we say, these are women with household which have at least one deprivation, which we have identified from SECC survey, and generally they are poor, therefore their land is not irrigated mostly. Therefore we focus on this whole concept of sustained agriculture, organic agriculture, so that they are able to sustain their farmlands also. So one is NKSP, and in this NKSP we have evolved the community resource persons who are called Pashu Sakhis, Krishi Sakhis. These are the cutting edge level people who are available, readily available, and well trained, mind you, because it's a very rigorous training which they undertake for 3 years. They are cross checked, and their level of training, learnings are verified, and then only they are designated as community resource person. So they are easily available to the community per se, and as their reputation grows, their services can be utilized by other people who are existing in the ecosystem. Thereby they earn some sort of value to themselves. So this is one. And therefore for non-farm livelihood, which we have another sub-program which we call SVEP, which is small small village entrepreneurship, startup village entrepreneurship program, where they start with some non-farm activity, and we have at least 50,000 plus such small scale entrepreneurs who have emerged. Many more, but these are the ones which have been recorded and registered. So now this is what has happened. Now we want to upscale them in under NREP, which has just been approved by the cabinet, and we are in the process of rolling out. Ma'am must have told about the initiatives which maybe with under DAY NREP and NREP they intend to take up, because Madhya Pradesh is also one state which is, we have 13 states where NREP is going to be launched, it has been launched, and MP is also one of them. So here we will focus on organic value chain, aggregation, farm gate, both farm gate processing, linking with market, and as a result we have created a Section 8 company also with for this value chain development, wherein we will identify the strengths both in farm and non-farm sectors existing in across these 13 states, and they will be handhold or they will be pushed towards a higher level of economic growth and livelihood. So these are few things, and organic, why we have taken up primarily, because as I said, most of our farmers or most of our SHG groups are come from the marginalized section, which their farmlands are mostly irrigated or not irrigated, but dependent on rain and other agroecological practice which are climate resilient, as was being mentioned by him. So there, because of the level of, if you can say, the level of economic growth which they have, this, if they want to grow in livelihood, some sort of enterprise will emerge, and electricity would be an important part in that. Whether it is a flour mill or a dal mill or husking of rice and all those things, or even a grinding the masalas, or some are weavers who might have doing it on a handheld chakha or something. So even in the till now we have some experiences where this solar irrigation pump has been the cycle which are put on the cycle mounted. They have been used in couple of states, and I must tell you this whole million soul program which have been done with IIT Bombay, this has been a brilliant success all over. Wherever we have been, it has been a very heartening success in all the states. Like in Assam, I had been recently. These women are doing the assembling part. So this was the initial thing, and then distributing it to the children. So as a result, that hours of study and those things which are not available to the village children, where there is even if electricity is there, maybe the hours of electricity may not be there in the evening time. So this simple device where it is solar charged, this lamp has helped in their education, one. Secondly, if I say for enterprise for these women, then these women have now some of them which have evolved into second grade, where they are doing the repairing part also. Apart from the solar lamps, they have created their own workshop, and they are very, if you go and see it at the village level, it is such a pleasure that they come together almost like going to office. They have evolved a uniform of themselves, maybe a sari of a different color, and there is a very well recorded thing where they keep that how many lamps have been assembled, packed, and everyone has a designated task. Somebody is doing the soldering, somebody is doing the, so it is like assembly unit with these women doing it. So one is that, then thirdly, then this the rice milling part has also been tried and tested on a small scale, and the solar charkha, UP is in the process of testing it out. because they have seen the success of it in the Khadi village industry. So they want their weaving cluster where there is a possibility to adopt this. So however, in this long term, when we go for NREDP upscaling, market linkage, this if these enterprises have to grow, then we have to first focus on ensured electricity supply. Yes. So maybe this can be a very good option.
On this energy, both the points that you made, the energy requirement of energy to power some of these value chain efforts and the opportunity these efforts itself create in terms of women involved in various service units. We'll come back to this. If Gauriji, if I were to come to you, you were sharing, if one could take up all these proven solutions and take up at a scale, it is like what one has seen with Kusum. So one is now just getting rolled out in a period of time. One is looking at a large scale. One is talking of 17.5 lakh standalone solar powered agriculture companies. So if one were to look at within the frame that you were saying of SRLM, these solutions at one end and intermediary on the ground like SRLM and the VOs and Federation, and look at a saturation level coverage of program levels. Or Sauvagya, where one is talking of each household getting connected. If you were to say that each household workspace, be it farm or any workspace, gets connected at a saturation level, what would it take?
I think what Leena has mentioned now, pretty much as just listening to her and thinking, that this is actually an opportunity, because for SRLM or NRLM at the national level to be able to scan the environment and to be able to bring out these kind of opportunities would be very difficult, because there's enough work per se which the just getting the project underway is actually a lot of work, because NREDP is now a new program and it will have to be rolled out. So I think this is really the time to create the kind of partnerships. At the national level, if SELCO could come in as a partner who could scan the environment and support, as it is doing now, entrepreneurs to use renewable energy and tag it with efficient machines, and actually get this database out there at the national level. It would help states to, not everyone should start doing it at their own state level, but that's actually the kind of role that can happen at the national level, and we then would just be able to access the kind of resource and the data that's available about many of these innovations that can be taken forward. And that actually, once this kind of a facilitation gets done at the national level, the states, it would be easy for the states to look at the natural clusters that exist within a state. And we also have a very large program called Rurban, which we are now, in fact, in SRLM, what we are doing at the state level is to combine the funding and the flow of funds from MGNREGA and from Rurban, which are both fairly large funds, along with SRLM, and get the focus to livelihoods. Now, if coupled with that, we can bring in entrepreneurs who have the capacity to address and to create solutions based on renewable energy for their livelihood purposes. I think that would actually be an extremely good fit and would allow upscaling to happen very fast. So just to give an example, that it's fine that I came and had a look at all the various innovations that have happened. But immediately I could start thinking of areas in Sydney and Balaghat which have large number of rice hulling machines that exist. And they need to be all put together in the urban area, because in the rural area you don't have that kind of electric supply. So this kind of innovation can immediately get picked up by women groups who, instead of selling rice with husk, would be able to actually sell, add value and sell it to the traders. Similarly with millets, I mean, it was quite obvious that the kind of supply that our farmer producer organizations are aggregating and then selling to Nasik, for example, are basically just the raw output. And if you actually could give them this capacity to do the dehusking and some element of polishing, you can imagine the kind of value add that it would give. So there is, to my mind, you know, there weren't so many available, you know, we didn't have, for example, the blacksmith entrepreneur showed us how they've got a DC motor done, which actually allows for the kind of, you know, blow that kind of energy that they require. But what I'm really saying is that I don't need to, as a state, be going out and looking for these solutions. If at the national level, right kind of partnerships get made, and there's a database that gets created, which allows us to immediately access these technology providers and take it to scale. Because the action is happening at the state level, sure. But we get so caught in trying to, you know, get the modalities of the program going that to be able to scan what is really readily available requires a different level of effort. So I think that's a huge opportunity that seems to have come up with the new program that has started with.
One, and ITP could look at and then try to raise solutions. The other thing you said that if a community were to look at, if a woman were to look at a solution like this, they could adopt, or a few words. So how do you create this interface closer to the end user?
See, I think the elements are all there. In a program like SRM, you have these elements, but I think you need to pull them all out and to hear the policy guideline, which actually gets these groups to move in the direction of livelihood. Right now, that's my sense, that most of these groups are so focused on savings and consumptive loans to each other, that we have really not unleashed their energy in the way that a good set of guidelines and framework can actually do it. So I don't see that there is a problem of funds. I just think that we've really not been able to put all the dots together to make it into a cogent piece that will allow groups to access funds for livelihoods. And once that starts happening, the natural second stage would be that you're looking at solutions for value add and you're looking at aggregations coming.
One thing with SELCO, we have been trying to put together in one place a demonstration. So now, as you were saying, when you saw these live demonstrations, your ideas immediately strike where this could connect, which kind of communities would find ready usefulness and meaningfulness for such solutions. If one were to look at creating such innovation demonstration spots closer to, say, in a district headquarter or at a regional level, something like that.
Why would you do that, Anish? I mean, I would probably say that if you have to create demonstration models, just create them with groups where this is a natural fit. So if you want to get, say, the de-husking implements of, say, millets, place them in villages and dindori, and that becomes like your demonstration unit, because unless your people are so used to looking at these things in, say, the KVKs or the in a lab-like situation,
that you don't actually get the connect. But when I see people like them actually using them to enhance their productivity, it's a natural, they can then actually put themselves in that situation and take it off.
Put it in
the context. Yes, sir. I think it's very right that if we put these type of equipments or these machines or whatever you call it, which eases that, which lessens the drudgery, increases their volumes of production, increases their output, and then thereby income also. Like for example, for the bulk milk chilling units, all these are powered by the solar panels. So they are being used, and if you go and see where these milk rooms are, these are actually really back of the beyond. Otherwise, would have not been possible if this energy was not being tapped. And this is happening in two SRMs, MP and Bihar for one. UP, they have just started it, and I think they will also, because the area where they are doing it is in Bundelkhand, where plenty of solar energy is there. So I think they would be also replicating. So I think I also quite agree that rather than again reworking and reinventing the whole wheel, which has been done somewhere nationally or at a distinct place, maybe identifying those technologies and if they are not suited to our nano enterprises, which are owned by individuals or clusters or group or PEs, whatever it is. So having a constant dialogue so that they are fine-tuned or made according, custom or tailor-made to our requirements, financially as well technologically also. Why is this solar irrigation pump is popular? Because it's just a switch device, which women can also operate easily. It does not require your brawn to be there, so that and you are dependent on some men in your family to work it. It leads to gender inclusion also and ease of adoption at all levels. So I think this is a very valid point which ma'am has raised.
Ma'am, I know you will have to leave in 5 minutes. Any concluding thoughts for this panel to look at in terms of all these three areas of surfacing solutions, adoption update, and enablement incentives?
Let me put it like this, that my concluding thoughts are about not, you know, struggling with trying to put policies together. My offer is that Madhya Pradesh is a state where we have a lot of mobilization that's already happened. We are absolutely receptive to getting in solutions that are powered by renewable energy, because that's the kind of areas that we operate in. Getting solutions with the normal electricity lines is still quite far away. And in fact, I would be actually happy to work with participants here and SELCO and all to put together those guidelines. Let's actually get them put together, put them out on the field, and then we'll wait for the national level to adopt them, adapt them, and take it forward.
This is something we must do in MP, and we'll put together a guideline with SELCO and team here, and let's start rolling it on the ground for us to get empirical evidence to.
Absolutely.
It will
also then allow people from other states to pick up those areas of intervention and scale it in their own states, and that's the way actually it will evolve. Because I know that right now, whenever a new initiative comes at the Government of India level, there's just too much happening for them to start leaning on all issues. So, since anyway states are the partner of this entire effort, I think it's a good idea to use the funding which will come in from NREP and use the mobilization on the ground and our own readiness and to be
be able to get the solutions going in
families. So that's a complete way forward. So we'll give whatever sharing as the financing manager session, you have many nuggets of wisdom. And one of the panelists did say that when we are looking at financing solutions at this level, the branch manager is a key player. Well, the requirements are at such a level that you need to engage, and the decision making is at the branch level. What could NABARD, you know, as you had you talked about the SDG and the kind of work that the SDG bank linkage you did with the bankers, something like that you think could be done in this space?
So if we look at the financing of sustainable energy based livelihood projects by banks, since yesterday there have been a lot of complaints against the banks. Sometimes I felt sorry, because if you look at the you have to look at the perspective from both sides. So from demand side, the issue is that borrower is not in a position to bring the back, and there is absence of long term debt, not maybe 5 years or 10 years later. From the supply side, the issue is there is no credit history, and a branch manager can never sanction a loan unless he is convinced about the repayment of the loan. So there has to be some credit history, and branch managers have to be convinced about the business plan. There should be a business case. So if the bank is giving loan, that loan should generate incremental income, and a part of incremental income should be used for incremental income. So there is something which is missing in between. So an institution like NABARD, we will play a constructive role to get that credit. So we have modern schemes which actually are used by banks for lending. So I mean, in these modern schemes, we have all the technical specifications, we have the project economics, cash flows, IRR, etc. More than 100 model projects are there on our website, which also includes two or three renewable energy-based projects. What I would like to invite SELCO, that let us collaborate, NABARD and SELCO, let us identify 8 to 10 sustainable energy-based livelihood projects, which can be easily financed by banks. Let's identify them. We will do the, we have to do some research for as regards their economics. Because if there is something which we are putting up on our website, it has to be absolutely credible, based on credible data. So perhaps some kind of exercise can be done, and we can financially support SELCO for doing this also. So once we have those 18 projects, banks will be very comfortable in lending to those projects.
So wonderful solution. This is something we put it on the model projects. So now I'll open it to the floor, and we can have, we have about 15-20 minutes, we can take three, four.
Hi, my name is Santosh, and I'm from Bayram District, LVT. And I was just going through ma'am's session, and she was talking about all these policies and these, and we have too much policies. To be honest with you all, my mom works all days in the farm, and she don't know even what is the policies available, how she can utilize it at the ground level, right? And even my dad went to. We have a farm with with the grandfather's name, right? We have divided our name, and then we can have the policies, the, whatever the availability we have. There is a gap happening in so many policies are there at the central and even the state. There is a gap how these policies are going to help me at the grassroots level, right? So, as a farmer, don't know what are the policies available and how can we uplift using those policies. So what is the process we are going to take, and how we're going to scrutinize things to help the grassroots level farmers and or young entrepreneurs? Please help on that.
We take a couple of more.
I'm Sabrita. I work with Art of Living Social Projects. So I have been to many villages, and like the sample that is there, that borewell now being run through solar energy. Now most of the borewells are below 500 feet. Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, wherever you go, these solar powered, they go just 300 feet. Right? So there are several issues. Again, my another question is that this is taking care of the energy. I'm sorry, digressing from the topic. But what I feel is the natural resource management is more important than providing solution, because see, wherever I have been, there are people are just going sugarcane. Unless we go into multi-cropping, we may give them solar powered sugarcane machine where they can take out their own jaggery, don't have to go to the factory. We can empower that way, but again, we are not making the natural resource management, which will have a greater impact with their income generation also.
That's the observation.
I'm Sudha Kuthari from Chaitanya, and we have the opportunity of being enlisted in National Empowerment by NRLN. So one of the programs we are doing with Jharkhand just now, the e-learning program in the city federations. But just now, based on the discussion and the exposure which happened yesterday and today, I see a lot of potential where the community investment fund, which is there at the VO level, in the whole structure, for experimentation of different energy devices which are appropriate at that level. So, and if a separate fund, I mean, till the regular mechanism evolves, something like Srinidhi, which is there in Andhra Pradesh for energy products, can there be a special line of fund which is available? So wherever the response is coming, they can immediately access. So if you can link up this possible. Andhra, they have a system where they access first from the Srinidhi and then gradually the bank makes it available. So the time which is goes in really accessing the loan has reduced a lot.
I think, ma'am, if I look at, I'm looking at Madhya Pradesh and I'll give you some numbers. Right now, the revolving fund has reached the several groups and they are interloaning and doing their small activities with it. But largely the fund CIF, which is lying with the VOs, which in the case of Madhya Pradesh we estimate as between 150 to 200 crores, is actually lying idle. So we are talking to a bank to come up with a solution wherein we can actually pool it under one account and give the VOs draw rights. But we don't need to put this fund in, say, 30,000 or 40,000 accounts and it being lying idle. But that's only one part of the thing. The other thing is that why is it lying idle is because the on-lending happens at 24%. Now you would, for all of you who work in the field, trying to get a livelihood activity which is sustainable at 24% just doesn't work. It doesn't even work at 12%. In fact, when we give loans to young entrepreneurs, we're looking at figures of something like 5 to 6% only. And when we talk about giving loans for livelihood to women, then we suddenly start looking at 12%, 15% and 24%. And then to expect them to actually make it viable and to be able to return it, and no one wants to take it for that reason. So as I was saying, that there are these elements that are already there in the program, but they need to be culled out and created into a cogent kind of a, whether we call it, give it some name in terms of a fund or whatever way we want to structure it. But unless these kind of funds which are available can be made easily available, whether for energy products or for other livelihoods, to the women who want to actually take it up in a structured way, they will continue to remain idle, and you know, we would be coming up, and you know, when we heard the numbers from Leena, I think the stark number that we heard was that while there are 50 million self-help groups, but there are only 50,000 entrepreneurs. Now,
this is because of this fund
program started in 15, and athletes started taking more than 17. So this SDG
is it's a new one.
It's a new one.
Okay.
So that is why
it, the numbers are
there. There was a lot of rigor in the concept.
So, I think what needs to be looked at is how do we actually start having, you know, entrepreneurs or livelihood groups who can start getting into income generating activities at scale. Because if you can't make it happen at scale, then, you know, this mobilization that you spend so much time and effort on will not yield the kind of potential that it has, you know, the opportunity of yielding.
I just been approved by the cabinet and we are in the process of rolling out. Ma'am must have told about the initiatives which maybe with under DAY NRLN and NRETT they intend to take up, because Madhya Pradesh is also one state which is, we have 13 states where NRETT is going to be launched, has been launched, and MP is also one of them. So here we will focus on organic value chain, aggregation, farm gate, both farm gate processing, linking with market, and as a result we have created a Section 8 company also with for this value chain development, wherein we will identify the strengths both in farm and non-farm sectors existing in across these 13 states, and they will be handhold or they will be pushed towards a higher level of economic growth and livelihood. So these are few things, and organic, why we have taken up primarily, because as I said, most of our farmers or most of our SHG groups are come from the marginalized section, which where their farmlands are mostly irrigated or not irrigated, but dependent on rain and other agroecological practice which are climate resilient, as was being mentioned by him. So there, because of the level of, if you can say the level of economic growth which they have, this, if they want to grow in livelihood, some sort of enterprise will emerge, and electricity would be an important part in that. Whether it is a flour mill or a dal mill or husking of rice and all those things, or even a grinding the masalas, or they, some are weavers who might have doing it on a handheld charkha or something. So even in the till now we have some experiences where this solar irrigation pump have been cycle mounted, they have been used in couple of states, and I must tell you this whole million soul program which have been done with IIT Bombay, this has been a brilliant success all over. Wherever we have been, it has been a very heartening success in all the states. Like in Assam I had been recently, these women are doing the assembling cart. So this was the initial thing, and then distributing it to the children. So as a result, that hours of study and those things which are not available to the village children, where there is even if electricity is there, maybe the hours of electricity may not be there in the evening time. So this simple device where it is solar charged, this lamp has helped in their education, one. Secondly, if I say for enterprise for these women, then these women have now some of them which have evolved into second grade, where they are doing the repairing part also. Apart from the solar lamps, they have created their own workshop, and they are very if you go and see it at the village level, it is such a pleasure that they come together almost like going to office. They have evolved a uniform of themselves, maybe a sari of a different color, and there is a very well recorded thing where they keep that how many lamps have been assembled, packed, and everyone has a designated task. Somebody is doing the soldering, somebody is doing the... So it is like assembly unit with these women doing it. So what is that? Then thirdly, then this the rice milling part has also been tried and tested on a small scale. And this solar charkha, UP is in the process of testing it out because they have seen the success of it in the khadi village industry. So they want their weaving cluster where there is a possibility to adopt this. So however, in this long term, when we go for NREDP upscaling, market linkage, this if these enterprises have to grow, then we have to first focus on ensured electricity supply. So maybe this can be a very good option.
On this energy, both the points that you made, the energy requirement of energy to power some of these value chain efforts and the opportunity these effort itself create in terms of women involved in various service industries. We'll come back to this. If Gauriji, if I were to come to you, you were sharing, if one could take up all these are proven solutions and take up at a scale, something like what one has seen with Kusum. So one is now it is getting rolled out a period of time. One is looking at a large scale. One is talking of 17.5 lakh standalone solar powered agriculture points. So if one were to look at within the frame that you were saying of SRLM, these solutions at one end and intermediary on the ground like SRLM and the views and federation, and look at a saturation level coverage of a program like this. Also, where one is talking of each household getting connected. If you were to say that each household workspace, be it farm or any workspace, gets connected at a saturation level, what would it take?
I think what Leena has mentioned now, pretty much I was just listening to and thinking that this is actually an opportunity, because for SRLM or NRLM at the national level to be able to scan the environment and to be able to bring out these kind of opportunities would be very difficult, because there's enough work per se which the just getting the project underway is actually a lot of work, because NREDP is now a new program and it will have to be rolled out. So I think this is really the time to create the kind of partnerships. At the national level, if SELCO could come in as a partner who could scan the environment and support, as it is doing now, entrepreneurs to use renewable energy and tag it with efficient machines, and actually get this database out there at the national level. It would help states to, not everyone should start doing it at their own state level, but that's actually the kind of role that can happen at the national level, and we then would just be able to access the kind of resource and the data that's available about many of these innovations that can be taken forward. And that actually, once this kind of a facilitation gets done at the national level, the states, it would be easy for the states to look at the natural clusters that exist within a state. And we also have a very large program called Rudban, which we are now, in fact, in SRLM, what we are doing at the state level is to combine the funding and the flow of funds from Mandrega and from Rudban, which are both fairly large funds, along with SRLM, and get the focus to livelihoods. Now, if coupled with that, we can bring in entrepreneurs who have the capacity to address and to create solutions based on renewable energy for their livelihood purposes. I think that would actually be an extremely good fit and would allow upscaling to happen very fast. So just to give an example, that it's fine that I came and had a look at all the various innovations that have happened, but immediately I could start thinking of areas in Sydney and Balaghat which have large number of rice hulling machines that exist, and they need to be all put together in the urban area, because in the rural area you don't have that kind of electric supply. So this kind of innovation can immediately get picked up by women groups who, instead of selling rice with husk, would be able to actually sell, add value and sell it to the traders. Similarly with millets, I mean, it was quite obvious that the kind of supply that our farmer producer organizations are aggregating and then selling to Nasik, for example, are basically just the raw output. And if you actually could give them this capacity to do the de-husking and some element of polishing, you can imagine the kind of value add that it would give. So there is, to my mind, there weren't so many available. We didn't have, for example, the blacksmith entrepreneurs showed us how they got a DC motor done, which actually allows for the kind of blow, that kind of energy that they require. But what I'm really saying is that I don't need to, as a state, be going out and looking for these solutions. If at the national level, right kind of partnerships get made, and there's a database that gets created, which allows us to immediately access these technology providers and take it to scale. Because if the action is happening at the state level,
sure.
But we get so caught in trying to get the modalities of the program going, that to be able to scan what is really readily available requires a different level of effort. So I think that's a huge opportunity that seems to have come up with the new program that has started with NRAP.
One might people look at advisory solutions. You said that the commission had to look at it, the government had to look at a solution like this, and they could adopt a few of us. So how do you create this interface closer to the end user?
See, the I think the elements are all there. In a program like SRLM, you have these elements, but I think you need to pull them all out and to gear the policy guideline, which actually gets these groups to move in the direction of livelihoods.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, that's my sense, that most of these groups are so focused on savings and consumptive loans to each other, that we have really not unleashed their energy in the way that a good set of guidelines and framework can actually do it. So I don't see that there is a problem of funds. I just think that we've really not been able to put all the dots together to make it into a cogent piece that will allow groups to access funds for livelihoods. And once that starts happening, the natural second stage would be that you're looking at solutions for value add, and you're looking at aggregations coming up.
One thing, with SELCO, we have been trying to put together in one place a demonstration. So now, as you were saying, when you saw these live demonstrations,
what ideas immediately strike, where this could connect, which kind of communities would find ready usefulness and meaningfulness for such solutions. If one were to look at creating such innovation demonstration spots closer to, say, in a district headquarter or at a regional level, something like that.
Do that, Anish. I mean, I would probably say that if you have to create demonstration models, just create them in with groups where this is a natural fit.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you want to get, say, the de-husking implements of, say, millets, place them in villages and dindori, and that becomes like your demonstration unit, because unless your people are so used to looking at these things in, say, the KEKs or the in a lab-like situation, that you don't actually get the connect. But when they see people like them actually using them to enhance their productivity, it's a natural, they can then actually put themselves in that situation and take it off.
Just said that I think it's very right that if we put these type of equipments or these machines or whatever you call it, which lessens the drudgery, increases their volumes of production, increases their output, and then thereby income also. Like for example, for the bulk milk chilling units, all these are powered by the solar panels. So they are being used, and if you go and see where these milk routes are, these are actually really back of the beyond. Otherwise, would have not been possible if this energy was not being tapped. And this is happening in two environments, MP and Bihar for one. UP, they have just started it, and I think they will also, because the area where they are doing it is in Bundelkhand, where plenty of solar energy is there. So I think they would be also replicating. So I think I also quite agree that rather than again reworking and reinventing the whole wheel which has been done somewhere nationally or at a distinct place, maybe identifying those technologies and if they are not suited to our nano enterprises, which are owned by individuals or clusters or group or PEs, whatever it is. So having a constant dialogue so that they are fine-tuned or made according, custom or tailor-made to our requirements, financially as well technologically also. Why is this solar irrigation pump is popular? Because it's just a switch device which women can also operate easily. It does not require your brawn to be there so that and you are dependent on some men in your family to work it. It leads to gender inclusion also and ease of adoption at all levels. So I think this is a very valid point which ma'am has raised.
Ma'am, I know you will have to leave in 5 minutes. Any concluding thoughts for this panel to look at in terms of all these three areas of surfacing solutions, adoption uptake, and enablement incentives?
Let me put it like this, that my concluding thoughts are about not, struggling with trying to put policies together. My offer is that Madhya Pradesh is a state where we have a lot of mobilization that's already happened. We are absolutely receptive to getting in solutions that are powered by renewable energy, because that's the kind of area that we operate in. Getting solutions with the normal electricity lines is still quite far away. And in fact, I would be actually happy to work with participants here and SELCO and all to put together those guidelines. Let's actually get them put together, put them out on the field, and then we'll wait for the national level to adopt them, adapt them, and take it forward.
This is something we must do in MP, and we'll put together a guideline with SELCO and team here, and let's start rolling it on the ground first to get empirical evidence too.
Absolutely. It'll also then allow people from other states to pick up those areas of intervention and scale it in their own states, and that way actually it will evolve, because I know that right now whenever a new initiative comes at the Government of India level, there's just too much happening for them to start thinking on all issues. So since anyway states are, they partner with this entire effort, I think it's a good idea to use the funding which will come in from NREPP and use the mobilization on the ground and our own readiness and to be able to get the solutions going in NREPP.
Fabulous. So that's a complete way forward. So whatever sharing as the financing end user session, you have many nuggets of wisdom. And one of the panelists did say that when we are looking at financing solutions at this level, the branch manager is a key player. Well, the requirements are at such a level that you need to engage, and the decision making is at the branch level. What could NABARD, as you had, you talked about the SDG and the kind of work that the SDG bank linkage you did with the bankers, something like that you think could be done in this space?
So if we look at the financing of sustainable energy based livelihood projects by banks, since yesterday there have been a lot of complaints against the banks. And sometimes I felt sorry, because if you look at the we have to look at the perspective from both sides. So from demand side, the issue is that borrower is not in a position to bring collateral, and there is absence of long-term debt, maybe 5 years or 10 years debt. From the supply side, the issue is there is no credit history, and a branch manager can never sanction a loan unless he is convinced about the repayment of the loan. So there has to be some credit history, and branch managers have to be convinced about the business plan. There should be a business case. So if the bank is giving loan, that loan should generate incremental income, and a part of incremental income should be used for repayment. So there's something which is missing in between. So an institution like NABARD, we will play a constructive role to get that bridge. So we have model schemes which actually are used by banks for lending. So I mean, in these model schemes we have all the technical specifications, we have the project economics, cash flows, IRR, etc. More than 100 model projects are there on our website, which also includes 2 or 3 renewable energy based projects. What I would like to invite to SELCO, that let us collaborate, NABARD and SELCO, let us identify 8 to 10 sustainable energy based livelihood projects which can be easily financed by banks. Let's identify them. We will do we'll have to do some research for as regards their economics. Because if there is something which we are putting up on our website, it has to be absolutely credible, based on credible data. So perhaps some kind of exercise can be done, and we can financially support SELCO for doing this also. So once we have those 8-10 projects, banks will be very comfortable in lending to those projects.
This is a wonderful suggestion, and this is something concrete way to put it on the model projects. So now I'll open it to the floor, and we can have, we have about 15-20 minutes, we can take C4. Yes. Yes. Say your name, mention it.
Hi, my name is Santosh and I'm from Bayram district, Elverti. And I was just going through ma'am's session and she was talking about all these policies and these, we have too much policies. To be honest with you all, my mom works all days in the farm and she don't know even what is the policies available, how she can utilize it at the ground level, right? And even my dad went to, we have a farm with with the grandfather's name, right? We have divided our name, and then we can have the policies, whatever the availability we have.
there is no gap happening in you know, so many policies are there at the central and even the state. There is a gap how these policies are going to help me at the grassroots level, right? So, as a farmer, don't know what are the policies available and how can we uplift using those policies. So, what is the process we are going to take and how we are going to scrutinize things to help the grassroots level farmers and or young entrepreneurs? Please help on that.
We take a couple of more.
I'm Sabrita, I work with Art of Living Social Projects. So I have been to many villages and like the sample that is there, that borewell now being run through solar energy. Now most of the borewells are below 500 feet. Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, wherever you go. These solar powered, they go just 300 feet. Right? So there are several issues. Again, my another question is that this is taking care of the energy. I'm sorry, digressing from the topic. But what I feel is the natural resource management is more important than providing solution. Because see, wherever I have been, there are people are just going sugarcane, sugarcane, sugarcane. Unless we go into multi-cropping, we may give them solar powered sugarcane machine where they can take out their own jaggery. Don't have to go to the factory. We can empower that way, but again, we are not making the natural resource management. It will have a greater impact with their income generation also.
That's the observation. So, yeah.
I'm Sudha Kuthari from Chaitanya, and we have the opportunity of being enlisted in the National Empowerment by NRLN. So one of the programs we are doing with Jharkhand just now, the e-learning program in the city federations. But just now, based on the discussion and the exposure which happened yesterday and today, I see a lot of potential where the community investment fund which is there at the VO level in the whole structure for experimentation of different energy devices which are appropriate at that level. So, and if a separate fund, I mean, till the regular mechanism evolves, something like Srinidhi, which is there in Andhra Pradesh for energy products, can there be a special line of fund which is available so wherever the response is coming, they can immediately access? So if you can link up this possible. Andhra, they have a system where they access first from the Srinidhi and then gradually the bank makes it available, so the time which is goes in really accessing the loan has reduced a lot.
I think, ma'am, if I look at, I mean, I'm looking at Madhya Pradesh, and I'll give you some numbers. Right now, the revolving fund has reached the self-help groups, and they are interloaning and doing their small activities with it. But largely the fund CIF, which is lying with the VOs, which in the case of Madhya Pradesh, we estimate is between 150 to 200 crores, is actually lying idle. So we are talking to a bank to come up with a solution wherein we can actually pool it under one account and give the VOs drawal rights. But we don't need to put this fund in, say, 30,000 or 40,000 accounts and it being lying idle. But that's only one part of the thing. The other thing is that why is it lying idle is because the on-lending happens at 24%. Now you would, for all of you who work in the field, trying to get a livelihood activity which is sustainable at 24% just doesn't work. It doesn't even work at 12%. In fact, when we give loans to young entrepreneurs, we're looking at figures of something like 5 to 6% only. And when we talk about giving loans for livelihood to women, then we suddenly start looking at 12%, 15% and 24%. And then to expect them to actually make it viable and to be able to return it, and no one wants to take it for that reason. So, as I was saying, that there are these elements that are already there in the program, but they need to be culled out and created into a cogent kind of whether we call it, give it some name in terms of a fund or whatever way we want to structure it. But unless these kind of funds which are available can be made easily available, whether for energy products or for other livelihoods, to the women who want to actually take it up in a structured way, they will continue to remain idle, and you know, we would be coming up, and you know, when we heard the numbers from Leena, I think the stark number that we heard was that while there are 50 million self-help groups, but there are only 50,000 entrepreneurs. Now,
this is because of this program started in 2015, and actually it started taking root in 2017. The PERs and all that. So this SDP
is a new one.
It's a new okay. So that is why
the
numbers are there. There's a certain rigor in the concept. So therefore, everybody cannot.
I think what needs to be looked at is how do we actually start having entrepreneurs or livelihood groups who can start getting into income generating activities at scale, because if we can't make it happen at scale, then this mobilization that we spend so much time and effort on will not yield the kind of potential that it has, the opportunity of yielding.
Thank you so much for coming to all of you, and having two of you on the panel, especially during election time. It's, I'm incredibly honored that you're here. Ma'am, you're coming up, and hope we wanted you to come here also, seeing that how do we bring up the whole scientific community in this country to relook at, see what happens in Bangalore, and especially in the Bangalore universities, is where the publishing papers becomes more important rather than what happens with the papers. So I hope we can influence the academic community with relooking at how do we look at, because otherwise the stark issues that people have brought up is not going to happen. And thanks, ma'am, for coming today. I know it takes 7 hours from door to door from Delhi, so you've taken 14 hours for this half an hour trip. But hopefully what we wanted was, how do you get a more practical dimension to NRLM, and with Gauri ma'am at the place that she is now, not in, in MP, is that whole philosophy for us is how do we integrate sustainable energy, not as a sustainable energy as a green thing, but it is a very much a developmental instrument for a country like ours. And for, if you have to look at 600 million people who have to get out of poverty in a manner that is sustainable, that we showcase that to the rest of the world, we believe that we are in the right spot, we means as a country, and how sustainable energy can play a role. And NABARD, with the amount of money that you have, and the flexibility of innovation that NABARD has been known for creating agricultural revolution, we really would be humbled and honored if the same thought process of agricultural revolution took place into energy revolution for us. And I'm glad that you are here, sir, and we're very glad that four of you have come in. And unfortunately, like, you have flights, because our last speaker is really, who was an instrumental in just before you, I just wanted to introduce the last speaker also before she comes in, who has been instrumental in pushing renewable energy access, especially around the world, is a champion of it, who created the whole practitioners forum in the UN Foundation, and has an enormous years of experience in running Trickle Up, one of the large NGOs before. And the concept of how impact investment should actually take place is what Richenda Vailuan will be the closing speakers. And I just wanted to introduce her to you before you left. I know all of you have flights, and Bangalore traffic is, it's completely clear today for all of you. So if you miss your flights, just call us. With a token of thanks to everybody.